Funding for this program was provided by the Academy of Florida Trial Lawyers, Florida Lawyers Association for the Maintenance of Excellence Incorporated, Mr. and Mrs. Steve Ufelder, and the Tallahassee Bar Association Incorporated.
Miles southeast of Tallahassee, off a quiet country road, sits a large stone monument bearing the inscription, "Lest We Forget," an ode to the memory of the events that took place there in the foggy pre-dawn hours of March 6, 1865. It was here where the St. Marks River flows into an underground cavern, creating a natural bridge, that a motley militia of old men, young boys, and a few Confederate soldiers defeated the Union troops who were attempting to take the Capitol. At the turn of the century, the annual celebration commemorating that victory was a favorite for Tallahasseans, among them a young LeRoy Collins.
On I think the last one I attended, there was an old man down there who had actually been in the forces that had come down from Tallahassee and had saved the Capitol. He had a big long stick, like a shepherd's stick, I guess, and he would stick that stick in the ground, and then he would dance a little dance, step around that stick, you know, as the band played the music for him. And the band was all coached and all to play for him. And we'd all gather around and laugh and hoot, because we didn't know what he was doing. Mm-hmm. We didn't realize what he was doing. But he would sing a little song, a little ditty, and he'd stick the stick down, and then he would dance around, and as he danced around, he would sing this little song about, "This is where I stood. This is where I stood." And he'd rail back, "This is where I stood." And he remembered, you know, the time, the event when he was actually there, and that's where he stood. When the chips were down and the Capitol was about to be taken over, well, he stood there to defend it. And I've thought many, many times since that time that that man wasn't cuckoo. He was right on the beam. And actually, I hope that in years to come that anybody can be looking around in the Capitol and browsing around for through the public records and through the journals of the Senate and the House of Representatives and the governorship, and that I would be glad if I was there for them to find where I had vetoed this bill or where I had taken this important stand to try to stand for a principle that I believed in, and that my ghost would be singing, "This is where I stood."
I, LeRoy Collins,
do solemnly swear
that I will support,
that I will support,
protect,
and defend
the Constitution and government of the United States.
The Constitution and government of the United States.
LeRoy Collins took the oath of office on January 4, 1955, to become Florida's 33rd governor. His good friend Dan McCarty had died while in office, and Collins was elected to serve out the remaining 2 years of his term. Like McCarty, Collins was a young progressive Democrat who wanted to lead Florida out of the old South into the mainstream of America.
So help me God.
I had a very ambitious program as governor. Oh, I must have had 15 different aspects of state government that I was anxious to change. And that first address of mine to the first session of the legislature, really, it was a big dose.
He had a large agenda of things he wanted to accomplish, the largest agenda any governor in Florida history had or has ever had.
He took on the toughest issues of the day: desegregation, constitutional revision, reapportionment, road building, government in the sunshine, fair tax evaluation. And he went to the people to talk to them about it. He educated them. He was a marvelous speaker.
We must move forward boldly and with an adventuresome spirit. We must not and we will not be deterred from our course by those of different purpose or by those of lesser faith. We must not procrastinate. We must not vacillate. We must not hesitate. So much to be done, so little time.
The sense of urgency which Collins brought to the governorship was due to the fact that he was elected for 2 years only. The Florida Constitution at that time prohibited a governor from serving consecutive four-year terms. Uncertain whether the law applied to his partial term, Collins nonetheless approached the job as if re-election was not a possibility.
Unfortunately, too, here with all these program ideas that I had and desires for improvement in the government and in road building and in all of these practical things that governors face, with all of that, I had disruption because of the racial issues that came to focus at that same time.
Those issues were the result of the Supreme Court decision in Brown versus the Board of Education declaring segregation in public schools unconstitutional. Like most southern states in the early 1950s, Florida was still clinging to the vestiges of its antebellum heritage. And though Collins believed the state constitution was outdated, he did not, at the beginning of his administration, feel that the southern tradition of segregation was wrong.
Segregation in our public schools is a part of Florida's custom and law. I will use all the lawful power of the governor's office to preserve this custom and law. Under our Constitution, that is my duty.
It's important, I think now, 35 years later, that we try to look back and remember not only how bad things were in race relations in the South and in Florida in the late 1950s, but also how these came upon the public officials in such a rush, it took them by surprise, Collins included.
There are many legal questions yet to be clarified by the United States Supreme Court. And prior to further judicial action, I think that any legislation on this subject will be premature. The promotion of legislation may well serve to inflame the passions of our people unnecessarily and develop an emotional atmosphere which will make the proper solution of our problems even more difficult.
Collins preached a moderate approach to desegregation. He continued throughout his administration to search for alternatives to confrontation. But the legislature was determined to challenge the law. They introduced multitudes of race-related bills, including proposals to close integrated schools, to make it unlawful to teach in integrated schools, and even a proposal to prohibit the discussion of integration. Collins vetoed most of these bills, but one, known as the Last Resort Bill, he considers the most important veto of his administration.
That bill would provide that if there was any school out there, there was dissension over racial feelings and all that, that the county school board would have the authority to close it down. Now that to me was really horrible, because I knew how easy it would be to develop that kind of pressure by the white citizens' councils or the whatever have you, Ku Klux Klan or whatever. They could develop a pressure that could justify closing that school.
When the legislature passed the interposition resolution, in essence denying the Supreme Court's right to force desegregation in Florida, Collins publicly denounced the resolution as a hoax and a fraud. On the face of the original document, he wrote, "Not only will I not condone interposition, as so many have sought me to do, I decry it as an evil thing whipped up by demagogues and carried on the hot winds of passion."
His attitudes towards desegregation changed over the period of years he was governor. And they changed because he changed his thinking somewhat.
I grew up in our Southland when it was legal, and I did not think unjust to expect the Negro to stay in a second-class status and to deny to him the full opportunities afforded by our society to other Americans.
His feelings of right and wrong kept coming back to him. He kept struggling with it. He kept talking about it with us. Most people told him to keep quiet. don't talk about it. Please don't say anything else about it. You know, just let it be. And he felt obligated as a matter of conscience to do this.
To be excluded from so very much of the main current of the life of your community and nation, to be reminded in countless big and little ways every waking hour that one is considered inferior, in short, to be a Negro in such a society must really be like being lynched a little bit, over and over again every day in a lifetime. And this is just what...
In 1955, the Florida Supreme Court had declared Collins eligible to run for re-election. By the time his campaign got underway, segregation had become the pivotal issue in the race.
A small incident occurred in the 1956 campaign that sums up LeRoy Collins better than anything else I can think of. It was in the depths, not the height, but the depths of the worst of the desegregation furor during that campaign. Charlie Ausley had a lot of friends in rural North Florida, and he would check with them from time to time, and Charlie Ausley was LeRoy Collins' law partner and close friend, former law partner. Known him for years. Charlie came into the governor's office after having been out to one of these rural counties, and he said, "Roy, it's gotten very serious." He says, "If you don't give the segregationists in this state something to tie to, you're going to lose this campaign for re-election." And I never will forget the look that came over LeRoy Collins' face. And he turned and he faced the window in the governor's office and he stared out of it for several moments. And he turned around, and when he did, an entirely different look was on his face. A look very much at peace, very quiet. And he said, "Charlie," he says, "you know," he says, "I don't have to get reelected, but I do have to live with myself."
People want somebody want their leaders to do the right thing as they understand them to be right. Now, there may be misunderstandings here or there, but the leader can explain is why he stands as he does. But to just to back down and cater to opinion that's just there against him without sound rational support, it's wrong.
Collins went on to win that election by the largest margin in Florida's political history. By now, many of the southern states were erupting in violence, but Florida remained relatively calm. Still, resistance was moving out of the courtrooms into the streets and businesses.
Friends, we've got mobs beginning to form now in this nation, in this Southland, and in this state. The time requires intelligent, careful, thorough study of big problems and the reaching of solutions that are going to be reasonable and sound and make good sense.
Protests and marches took place around the state. In February, 11 students from the Black University in Tallahassee were arrested for participating in a sit-in demonstration at a local Woolworths. They were protesting the law that denied them the right to be served with whites at the same lunch counter. The potential for violence was dangerously high.
Hundreds of adventurous white youths from Tallahassee and from outlying rural areas drifted into the city. There was a run at the stores on such articles as axe handles and hammers. Carloads of youths toured city streets jammed with Saturday traffic, flying Confederate flags from car aerials.
The eyes of the nation were focused on Florida, and Governor Collins was ashamed of what they were seeing.
We've got extremists on one side, and we've got extremists on the other. We've got this mob shouting here, we've got this mob shouting there. Where are the people in the middle? Why aren't they talking? Why aren't they working? They must start working.
In Florida's first live statewide broadcast, Collins went before the people. Without the benefit of a prepared speech, he talked candidly about race relations.
Now, so far as I'm personally concerned, I don't mind saying that I think that if a man has a department store and he invites the public generally to come into his department store and trade, I think then it is unfair and morally wrong for him to single out one department, though, and say that he does not want or will not allow Negroes to patronize that one department. Now, he has a legal right to do that, but I still don't think that he can square that right with moral, simple justice.
I think the governor was trying to and wanted to challenge the people. He did then and has always had a deep faith in people if given the opportunity to be their best. But he felt it had to sometimes be drawn out of them. It had to be pointed out to them. And he wanted to challenge the people of Florida to view this and to think about it, you know, in their homes and in their schools as to what was morally wrong and what was morally right.
Mr. Stillman, what are your impressions of Governor Collins' talk on television
today? I agree with the governor that the Negro population should have the privilege of making their purchases in any of our stores the same as any other group of people.
They need a little more time. They have been making progress, and slowly the white man is starting to, consider the Negro.
I think today would be hard for anybody who didn't live through those years and wasn't following those developments to realize what kind of courage it took for an elected official to make that kind of statement.
Well, like I said, it's a little too soon for them to get together like that with the white.
Well, actually, in my opinion, it's up to the proprietor.
Well, at least he had enough courage to come out in the open. We're all God's children, you know. They fought the war side by side with other boys. Why shouldn't they eat side by side with them?
I think the governor was the first governor ever to say that across the nation. I don't know that any high official in the national government had yet said that. He said it as a southern governor in a southern state when nobody else had ever dared say it. And he came to that view from his conscience. It evolved, he dragged it out of his own conscience.
There was always in my spirit and in my feelings, deep inside, the knowledge that blacks had been afflicted with terrible injustices. And and even looking at it from the standpoint of what is just and what is right and what is reasonable, which we certainly all have an obligation to do, well, we had to change our ways.
LeRoy Collins was born on March 10, 1909. His mother was a schoolteacher, his father a grocer. One of six children, young LeRoy grew up in Tallahassee in the heart of Florida politics, just a few blocks from the mansion he would one day occupy as governor.
It was a little town, it was limited, but that gave me an opportunity to know most everybody. I knew the governors, and being in a capital city like this was a tremendous advantage to me because I grew up recognizing and being able to talk to the superintendent of public instruction or the attorney general or the governor or whoever in public life. They would usually mingle down around Fane Drugstore and talk and argue and bombast each other. And I just was eagerly but quietly sitting around, you know, taking a lot of that in.
Collins' interest in politics grew with the encouragement of his ninth grade English teacher, who took a special interest in him.
He started a conversation that I shall always remember. He started out by saying in our interview after the class was out and all gone, that he believed that I had some special qualities that I could take advantage of and it would be very, very meaningful to me and to other people. And he hoped that I would realize the potential that was there and find ways to take advantage of that potential.
As the grandson of a Methodist minister, Collins began developing that leadership potential, teaching Sunday school.
I found, as a growing up boy, that the church and its organizations, youth organizations, just gave me a wonderful opportunity to be out front, so to speak, mm-hmm. and to take part and to participate in their organization work. And my mother and father, of course, were very rigid in their discipline of right and wrong and good and bad, and they expected us to hoe a close row or plant a close line.
He was brought up in a family that was family-oriented and had a strong religious faith, and I think that background has influenced him always.
Dad is just an example of strength and faith, and I do think the faith is a critical ingredient because that was something he grew up with from an infant. It wasn't something new that he discovered later in life. And I think that just built a strong foundation.
The influence of the church is also evident in his passionate style of public speaking.
And he said, "Bring me a bowl of water." And when he got the water, he washed his hands in it. And he said to that crowd, "I will not let the blood of this righteous man be on my hands. I wash my hands of it. See to it yourself." And they did see to it themselves. They crucified him.
His speeches are masterpieces. You go back and read them today. They're literature. I mean, he was, I think, probably the finest orator I've seen in the 60 years I've been around. The man is ultimately eloquent, and what he said was priceless. He had the art of oratory down.
I have seen him work over a speech and work over it and work over it. And he was a very careful craftsman. He wanted things to be said correctly and said properly, and he wouldn't settle for just dashing off a speech and letting it go. He wanted it to be just right.
Many years ago, I heard of a father who one night went to his son's room to see if he were tucked in and asleep. He entered the room very quietly and then realized that his son was on his knees saying his prayer. And he overheard his boy say clearly, "Dear God, help me to grow up to be the kind of a man my daddy is." The father withdrew unnoticed, and he went straight to his own room. And there he went down on his own knees, and he prayed, "Dear God, help me to be the kind of man my little boy wants me to be."
She has had perhaps a stronger influence on his life than anyone else, and probably stronger than she herself realized.
She is Mary Call Darby Collins, great-granddaughter of Florida's first territorial governor, Richard Keith Call, and daughter of a state senator from Palatka. With their marriage, they formed not only a family, but a political partnership.
She took a very great interest, not only in personal matters, but in his work and his professional activities, and that he consulted her on these things, I do believe.
It was with Mary Call's encouragement that Collins undertook his first bid for office when he ran for county prosecutor in 1932.
If he said if he won that we'd get married, well, of course he lost and we still got married.
Undaunted by that first defeat, he ran for a seat in the Florida House of Representatives in 1934 and won.
When I first ran for the legislature, I was determined to do something about public education in Florida. And I felt that the legislature was a good place to get that done, a place within my reach at least, that I could make some progress in that field.
After 6 years in the House, he won a seat in the Senate in 1940. It was there that he championed the controversial Minimum Foundation Bill. The passage of that bill marked the beginning of the modernization of Florida's education system.
I had seen the inadequacies of our schools and the lack of reasonable financing for our schools and the variability in support for schools. We had some good schools and some horrible schools, but there was no uniform level of achievement that the state demanded and was willing to pay for.
Originally, we'd had very local control, so people with a large, high tax base and not many poor people had better schools than areas where they had poor people. He saw that everybody got a satisfactory education.
It just sealed in the concept that children of whatever color, whatever race, whatever kind, wherever located, they were going to get a sound education through the high school.
He considered his own education modest. After graduating from high school, he took 6 months of instruction at a business school in Poughkeepsie, New York, and came home to work in a bank. Later, at the urging of Supreme Court Justice Glenn Terrell, he enrolled in a one-year program at Cumberland Law School, where he earned his degree.
I didn't feel that I could afford and we were able for me to go to college. And that was at a time when I realized some of Tallahassee's shortcomings, because we had a women's college here, but the boys couldn't go there. And we had a black college here, but the white boys couldn't go there. So there was no place to go to college beyond high school here.
Vowing to alleviate that situation, Collins carried his crusade for improved education into his governorship. Under his administration, a system of community colleges was developed, putting a facility within commuting distance of every citizen in Florida. He also recognized the potential of television as an educational tool. Traveling to Washington, he lobbied the FCC for enough high-powered channel allocations to blanket the state with what would become Florida's educational television system.
They granted us all of those channels. Now, they would have done the same thing, I think, for any other state. But other states didn't even ask for them. And now they're scrounging around trying to raise $50 million here and $75 million there to buy one station like that. And that's just one of the things that I wanted us always to be alert to opportunities, because there were so many changes that were developing.
It was clearly a time of transition for Florida. As one of the fastest growing states in the nation, Collins recognized the need to develop clean new industries to enhance an economic base heavily dependent on tourism and agriculture.
He was a salesman. He sold Florida. He was the best salesman Florida's ever had, really.
Under his administration, the Florida Development Commission was established, and Collins traveled the nation, seeking out industry leaders, promoting the warm business climate of the Sunshine State.
See, Florida was his life, and so when people would visit Florida, or when he would go with a group and visit various elements of business and industry, again, his sincerity and his strength and his honesty, he could attract people, and he did attract people.
Take Martin of Orlando, the state's largest private employer. When they moved to Florida, they received over 20,000 applications from everywhere in the country, from skilled, hard-to-recruit technical personnel.
With new people came new needs, and the Collins administration responded, building new roads, an interstate highway system, and a turnpike to accommodate a growing population. With acquisition of lands for state parks and recreation areas, and with the creation of a system of public health facilities in every substantially populated area of the state. In his 6 years as governor, Collins saw a remarkable number of his programs enacted. But one of his major goals, reapportionment of the Florida legislature, was not accomplished until after his administration had ended.
We had a horrible situation in Florida, worst in the United States. We had 17% of the population of Florida electing over a majority of the legislative representation in Florida. And that was just unbelievably wrong.
But it was up to the legislature to reapportion itself according to population. The small rural counties that had controlled the House and Senate since the late 1800s were not about to surrender power to the growing urban areas.
Reapportionment was an issue that he never let go of, that he never let up on, that he never backed away from. He kept coming to it. He kept asking the legislature to do it. He kept calling for special sessions to do it. He got special sessions. He didn't get the results. He called, you know, he used every measure he could, and in the end, didn't accomplish it during his term.
Now, when the Constitution itself provides for the reapportionment of representation in the legislature, and when that is persistently and adamantly and arbitrarily denied to people over a long period of time, in my judgment, in time, the courts are going to step in and say that we alone...
As Collins had predicted, the issue did go before the courts, who ruled that the legislature had denied the citizens fair representation.
And so the courts wound up reapportioning Florida. But we laid the groundwork. In fact, the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court told me in Washington in a conversation later, when he was asking me about some of my failures and some of my successes in the legislature, and when I mentioned that we had failed to get reapportionment, well, he said, oh, no, you didn't. You didn't fail. I said, yes, I did, too. And he said, Governor, if you hadn't been saying those things and doing those things in Florida, and they hadn't been saying some of those things in some other parts of the United States, this court would never have reversed those old decisions.
One issue the governor faced that was never resolved to his satisfaction was that of capital punishment. Though required by law to sign the death warrants, it was a responsibility he carried out with great reluctance.
He carried out the law, but it hurt him, and hurt him deeply. And I think it was one of the most difficult times he had to deal with. But he was opposed to the death penalty, but he did carry out the law of the state.
When I was governor of the state, the worst duty I had to face was the black border death warrant, which from time to time came to my desk. Even as a mandatory official act, it is a soul-wrenching experience to put your name to a document which will send another human life crashing into an uncertain eternity.
I recall that any time that someone was convicted of a capital crime, that he made the families of that person, he made his office available and his person available. Sometimes they even visited him at the mansion.
It was sad days. Every time we killed one, I sat there in my office and it wasn't easy to get my mind off of it. I remember one particular boy that we had that was one of these, what did you call these Navy people that in World War II frogmen, and he had gone through terrible experiences and risks and all in connection with that. And he had a problem down in Jacksonville. He killed a police officer. And he had a fine record otherwise. But he was executed. And there was great pressure from Jacksonville that he be executed. And I called up the warden after he was executed, and I said, I wish you'd get a little American flag and put on his grave for me, because I wanted, even with all the pain and sorrow of the crime that he committed, still he had served his country, and he served his country well, too, in that lifetime, brief as it was.
By far the great majority of those we executed were Negroes, yet only around 17% of the state's population was colored. I strongly urged our legislature to repeal the death penalty, but it was not willing to do so. In recent years, more and more governments have done this, and Florida will also in time.
He also never hesitated to break a mold. Constitutional revision, coming out against capital punishment, reapportionment, all of these things that nobody would touch. He never hesitated to go out and say, break that old vessel because it no longer serves the time.
He loves change. As a matter of fact, I think of him as the Picasso of politics because, you know, Picasso would perfect a certain artistic technique, and it would shock everyone. I think that Daddy's like that, too.
Because I can't understand how anyone can come down and see this firsthand, can walk here and talk to the people here and get the feel of the problems here and then deserve a label of that kind that he simply is indifferent and doesn't care. I tell you now, I care.
Change is essential in human life and political life and in every other human activity. But there's a sound basis, I think, that we should search for of how to change to meet new needs and new circumstances and new conditions and yet do it in a happy spirit and with a feeling that in that change there is accomplishment and there's progress and there's hope and there's reality of a better future.
Government too must have qualities of the spirit. Truth and justice and fairness and unselfish service are some of these. Without these qualities there is no worthwhile leadership and we grapple and grope in a moral wilderness.
Perhaps the most significant change during the Collins administration was the public perception of a newfound integrity in government. Collins was the first to use the phrase government in the sunshine.
The legislature still largely worked itself in a closed-door, smoke-filled room atmosphere. They came to secret understandings. They made, you know, they came to their private understandings. And they didn't want the public in on it. The governor's attitude was totally different than that.
In my first address to the legislature after I became governor, I brought this subject up. And I specifically called to their attention that special sessions and secret sessions of the legislative as well as other public bodies ought to be discontinued and they ought to be open wide for the press to participate in, see, and therefore give the people the understanding of what was going on.
He wanted the people in his administration to understand that each one of us was accountable and that we were accountable to him, but ultimately to the people. And it was a way of ensuring decency and integrity and honor. And that was such an essential part of his personality.
I think the members of the press felt and understood what I was seeking to achieve, and that I was in favor of more openness in government and a closer and an open relationship with the press.
By working with the reporters in Tallahassee and those such as I when I was with the St. Petersburg Times, he was able to show them a vision that he had for the state of Florida, and each of them would capture something of the spirit of what he was trying to do.
I like press people. They challenged me. They really made me want to be a better governor. They let me know of standards they had for quality in government and good government and good leadership in government, and that was good for me.
And it was good for the state of Florida as well. By 1960, Collins' reputation for fairness and integrity propelled him into the national spotlight when he was chosen to preside over the Democratic National Convention in Los Angeles.
This is your permanent chairman, the Honorable Governor LeRoy Collins of the great state of Florida.
Because of the bitter rivalry between Kennedy and Johnson, the convention was expected to be chaotic. But Collins handled it skillfully, presiding with a gracious authority as the nomination for president went to John Kennedy.
Governor Collins, 51 years old, graduate of Cumberland University, a World War II veteran, he's married.
At one point during the convention, Collins himself was under consideration as a possible running mate for Kennedy, but the nomination went to Lyndon Johnson instead.
It was possible that I could have mounted something there to at the end of that convention that might have gone a ways, but it didn't make really good political sense because I was regarded as a liberal in the view of this race relations development that back home had divided people so sharply. And I think over the whole South, I was a Southerner, but in many ways I was tainted as a Southerner because of what some of the speeches and all that I had made and things I'd said and done.
Not everyone shared that perception. With his final term as governor ending, Collins was approached by the National Association of Broadcasters. They were looking for a president, and Collins appeared to fit their needs.
When Collins was hired by the National Association of Broadcasters, was on the heels of the quiz show scandals, the rating stink. I mean, the broadcasters had a very bad image. And they looked at Collins at the 1960 convention and they said, there's a man whose image we want to rub off on us. So they hired him for what he could do for his image. What they forgot was that behind his image was an awful lot of substance there. And that substance, not all of the broadcasters really liked.
I was very excited about taking this job. I had used the media considerably. I felt that the media had a great need to identify with the public interest, the broadcast media. Accept more responsibility for helping shape the future of our society and our government. And the committee that came to talk to me about it, that's the way I talk with them. And that's what they said, that's exactly what we need in broadcasting.
He proceeded to take them at face value. And when they said, we want you to come in and provide leadership to this industry, well, by George, he did. Scared them to death. Absolutely scared the networks to death because he said these ratings are baloney, which of course they are.
He pushed for more news and public affairs programming, and when cigarette companies began targeting young people in their advertising, he became furious. He called for a review of the commercials in spite of the huge profits they generated.
I think a man who's grown or a woman who's grown can make his or her own decision on a matter of this kind, but where you've got young people very impressionable, very anxious to succeed and to be sophisticated and to be grown up, and you've got the kind of advertising that seems to equate success with smoking, I think it's a very dangerous and a very insidious thing.
America's goals must be broadcasting's goals. For if broadcasting is to endure as a free institution in a free society, the best interests of broadcasting must coincide with the public interest.
We shall overcome.
In 1963, freedom had not yet been extended to all segments of society, and the Civil Rights Revolution was sweeping the nation.
I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up, live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal.
With the signing of the Civil Rights Act of 1964, motels, restaurants, theaters, and other public facilities would be open to blacks on an equal basis for the first time. To help communities desegregate peacefully and learn to work together, the Community Relations Service was established. To direct this new agency, President Johnson called on Governor Collins.
He said, "Everybody seems to feel like you're the one that's got to do this." And he said, "I'm not asking you to do it as a political favor, so it's going to be a disfavor. It's going to do you, it'll hurt probably more than it'll help you. But I'm asking you for the people of the United States."
The job was full of political risk for a leader from the troubled South. Still, Collins accepted the position, as well as the difficult restrictions that went with it. Unlike the Justice Department, the agency had no enforcement powers. And on the assumption that their activities would be more successful if done quietly, members of the agency were prohibited by law from publicizing their work.
It was a very difficult job. It was different than most people have assumed since. Most people have assumed that I was just trying to put out racial fires in a direct sense of going there and where the fire was burning and pouring water on it and stopping it. It wasn't that at all. I mean, I was concerned deeply with the basic underlying causes and the need for changes in the basic elements that were involved in this thing, and the need for better...
The Community Relations Service under Collins' directorship accomplished a great deal toward the goal of establishing racial harmony. But for LeRoy Collins, it was his courageous efforts in a small Alabama town that marked the beginning of the end of his political career.
Selma sprang overnight from an obscure southern town to the front pages of world newspapers. This church was headquarters in the Negro drive for the right to vote. And it was here that Martin Luther King came to lend his support to the campaign. He pointed out that from Selma's 14,000 Negroes, only a few more than 300 had been registered at the polls. When one group set out to march to the Capitol at Montgomery, the procession was broken up violently by state troopers and sheriff's deputies.
Defeated on the Edmund Pettus Bridge, the marchers vowed to return in spite of a court order prohibiting them from doing so.
The president called me personally and said, "I want you personally to go down there because this is can be a very embarrassing thing to the nation." And so I went, and there I found two opposing forces. They were just arrayed, determined. They were absolutely deadlocked. There wasn't any motion anywhere. And they were heading right for another catastrophic confrontation and tragic happening there at that bridge.
It was really quite vintage Collins, what happened there. You know, this was a big extraordinarily perilous development, and he won that thoroughly justified his going in person.
It was my job to try to see if I could help find a solution that both sides could agree to that would avoid that confrontation and let the issues be settled in the courts or settled elsewhere around tables and all this sort of thing, and not out there in the streets where people were getting hurt and killed.
It took him all night, shuttling between separate meetings with Dr. King and law enforcement officials, but by dawn he had worked out a compromise to which both sides appeared to agree. The authorities would not advance as long as the marchers agreed to proceed only across the bridge, stop, hold a brief prayer service, and then return to Selma to await a court ruling lifting the injunction against the march.
Governor Collins, on that day, positioned himself between the conflicting parties, right in the middle, as a matter of fact. And if violence had occurred, Governor Collins would have been right in the middle of the disturbance. He said afterward that he was determined that if one of those state troopers, highway patrolmen, or if one of those deputies had moved when the march stopped and had moved toward the marchers, he was determined to grab him. He said, I don't know what I would have done with him, but I sure was going to try.
The troops and deputies stand stolidly by as the prayers are said and the marchers go back to Selma. This Alabama town will go down in the history books as a turning point in the civil rights drive. From the halls of Congress to the smallest crossroads hamlet, people can understand the plea that no American can have freedom and justice unless there is freedom and justice for all. In Selma, there is a lesson to be learned.
Collins spent a year with the Community Relations Service, followed by another year as Undersecretary of Commerce. In 1968, his desire to serve Florida brought him home from Washington to run for the U.S. Senate.
Governor Collins, do you think your work with the Community Relations Service has affected your return to Southern politics? Do you think it will have been a bad effect, or do you think it will have an ill effect, or do you think it will have had no impact?
I don't look at it that way. I think that the work I've done with the Community Relations Service has been highly important. And I don't do my work thinking in terms of what effect it might have on politics in the future. I do my work as well as I can do it. And I believe this usually brings a man out on the favorable side with people, because I think people expect that of a leader.
In 1968, LeRoy Collins was the most qualified person in Florida to serve in the United States Senate. But from the beginning of the campaign, from the first day, a pall hung over that campaign like a dark cloud. And that pall was spelled Selma.
All they had to say in that campaign to beat me was he was at Selma, period. They didn't have to say what I was doing there or why I went there or the other things that I was seeking to accomplish there, or the other work that I was doing with the Community Relations Service. He was at Selma.
On his return from Washington, Collins campaigned hard, winning the Democratic primary. But when the Republican opposition circulated this picture of him at Selma, it was too much for conservative Florida.
When I would go home in that campaign, and I went as I did when I could, and I remember once I found my wife tearful, and she had been crying. And I said, what on earth is the matter? And she said, well, I was talking with our good friends, and she named them today, and they told me that they had always supported you in every campaign, but that they were not going to support you in this one, because they didn't believe that your thinking was straight in respect to race relations. And she said, she told them, said, well, Roy just believes in liberty and justice for all. Now that's in our Pledge of Allegiance. Don't you believe that? And she said, they just turned away and said, well, I don't want to get any argument with you. But this hurt.
The tough part for all of us was that he'd spent, 35 or almost 40 years in public office by that time, in and out of public office. He's in the Navy also. But during that period of time, you work so hard to do the right things, and you look back over that record, and it's just sterling the whole way. And then when you submit yourself to the people again, well, about the only thing that people can say on the debit side of the ledger is that you're too liberal. Well, you know, what does that mean?
He really didn't lose anything. He stood for what he believed, and he's proud of that. And it would have been a loss if he had really taken any other kind of position, I think.
LeRoy Collins is not a man to give in to the spirit of defeat. After the campaign, he retreated to his beloved Dog Island, where he wrote the book Forerunners Courageous, Stories of Frontier Florida. Proceeds from the sale of the book helped pay off his campaign debts, and soon he was back serving on committees, advising political leaders, and looking for new ways to serve the state he loves.
I think there are opportunities out there now, and always will be, where people can see needs and then have the interest to fashion and the power to fashion programs to meet those needs, and then the leadership that's required then to get public acceptance of programs of that sort. And that's, to me, that's the glory of government.
Funding for this program was provided by the Academy of Florida Trial Lawyers, Florida Lawyers Association for the Maintenance of Excellence Incorporated, Mr. and Mrs. Steve Ufelder, and the Tallahassee Bar Association Incorporated.